Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the creation of my real self presentation, Jesus examines the choice God made to create our soul, which is our real self. What our condition was at the time of creation and incarnation. What God's creation of ourselves tells us and summarizes our current undeveloped state. Recorded on the 27th of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Now, this section of our program, the reality is I could spend months on it. So, you know, you're only going to get, again, one of those skim across the top discussions on these subjects now. But hopefully they'll give you many things to ponder and also some things to experiment with when it comes to developing your loving self. So now we've come to the part of the program which is about developing my loving self. So the whole of the next 2 days we'll be discussing what you need to understand to help you develop your loving self. And obviously part of developing your loving self is about removing your unloving self. So let's assume that we've understood our unloving self and we've removed our unloving self, or we're in the process of removing our unloving self. And this is about developing our loving self. Now, what do we need to know and do in order to develop our loving self, to become more loving, if you like? Now, this part of the program relates a lot and can be engaged also at the same time as the other part of the program can be engaged. So it doesn't have to be sort of put off until you've developed, you know, until you've deconstructed your facade. In some ways, it's almost like your real self and your unloving self, you know, the hurt self and the facade selves, can be two of them can be deconstructed simultaneously to the other being constructed. But before we can do anything about it, we need to understand the creation of my real self. We need to understand how God created us. And we need to understand God's truth about how God created us. So that's what we're going to do now, try to understand some truth about how God created us and the state we are in right now as well. Okay, so let's focus on God's creation of ourselves, of myself. I'll write a statement. I am the pinnacle of God's creation. But I want to define I. I is my entire soul. So whenever you say I, you're really not saying, you're not really talking about the same thing, are we? So whenever I say I, I'm talking about Mary and I, both of us together as one. All right, so in my case, it's like this. And that part of the soul has been named by my first parents, because it's the very first incarnation that you really take most of your names from. So that part of my soul is Jesus, and that part of my soul is Mary. And Mary Magdalene we're referring to there, right? But we are one person, one being, one soul. Does that make sense? Okay. Now that is a very, very, I've said this to you many times before, and still the majority of you just do not get it. It's a very significant truth. Because it's the whole soul that has a relationship with God. It's the whole soul that can be developed in love. Now, there's a number of things in here that you probably haven't given too much thought about every time we've raised this issue. What does it mean that I am the pinnacle of God's creation? Well, let's talk a bit about what that means. It means that you are the most complex of all of God's creations. The human soul is actually more complex than the universe in which the human soul lives. The human soul is the most complex of all of God's creations, and the human soul is actually more complex than the physical universe in which the human soul lives. So, now that opens a wide, you could say a whole, you know, lifetime of investigation that would open, wouldn't it? If you think about it, you can spend tens of millions of years examining the universe and you still won't know its full complexity. What does that tell you about the human soul? That you could spend the same amount trying to understand the human soul and you still won't know its full complexity. Because the human soul is a very interesting creation by God in that it's constantly changing based on how much love it receives. So just when you think you've caught up with, you know, understanding how it is right now, you receive a little bit more love and all of a sudden the human soul has new capacities that it didn't have before. And therefore it's just become a little bit more complex than it did before. So the human soul is a growing complexity. The difference between the human soul and the universe itself is that there are fixed laws that govern the universe, and I suppose you could say there are also fixed laws that govern the human soul, but the universe itself does expand, but it expands in the same manner in which or under the control of the human soul. The human soul is like not only the most complex of God's creations, but also has the most potential for change of all of God's creations. It is also the only one of God's creations that is self-realizing. And that in itself causes huge amounts of complexity. It's the only one to whom God gave the gift of free will. That in itself causes huge amounts of complexity. Because it means that God had to create a whole series of laws which are just specific to and for only the human soul and the way in which it would grow. And if the human soul didn't exist, all of God's highest laws would not exist either. Because all of the highest laws in the universe all relate to the human soul. So all of the laws that are surrounding the laws of divine love, some of which we've talked about, laws of desire, forgiveness, repentance, the laws governing the reception of God's love and so forth, they are the most powerful laws in the universe and they govern the way the human soul operates. And the least complex of the laws governing the human soul is the law of compensation. You'd like to ask.
Could you explain a bit about why that is? I feel totally lost when you say that.
Well, there's two types of laws that God created surrounding the governance of the human soul. Some of the laws relate to how the human soul operates without its awareness, and some of the laws are based upon the human soul having awareness. So the law of compensation is a law that operates upon the human soul without the human soul necessarily needing to have awareness of the law itself. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
it's a bit like the way the law of gravity operates upon the physical body. You don't need an awareness of the law of gravity. You don't need to know and understand it, but it still operates upon the body. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And the same applies with the law of compensation. But the law of compensation operates upon the soul, but you don't need to be aware of its operation. It will continue to operate upon the soul. So that's a law that's based upon whether you're ignorant or aware, will continue to operate. It's one of the lowest laws, just like the law of gravity is one of the lowest laws that determine what happens to physical objects. The law of compensation is one of the lowest laws that determine what happens to your soul. Does that make sense?
Yep.
But then there's a whole group of laws that govern the human soul that are actually based upon the cognizance or the recognition of the human soul of those particular laws. In other words, the human soul needs to understand the law in order to embrace the operation of the law. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And those kind of laws are things like the law of repentance, law of forgiveness, the law of receiving divine love, law of desire, and so forth, right? Those laws are higher laws governing the human soul because they require the human soul's engagement of the law. They require the human soul to be aware of and to engage the law appropriately in order for the law to operate. Does that make sense?
Yeah, to a degree.
Yeah. So, and I know I'm speaking of things that possibly have not considered before, but what I'm saying is this human soul, the whole series of laws that govern the human soul are the highest laws because they also govern the highest creation. And the human soul is the highest creation of God. And therefore, God created a whole heap of the highest laws of God in order to govern the highest creation of God. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So if you think about how not only how clever that is, but how much love must have gone into that. You know, once you understand the laws, you realize how the human soul can't be an accident, because there's all these laws that are all very fixed in their operation that govern the human soul, and therefore, you know, if there is law, there has got to be a creator of a law in order to have that law be effectual. And obviously, a law requires a designer. Just like here on Earth, we have laws created by governments. The governments get together and create a law, and that means they designed the law. Well, God too also designed the laws that govern the human soul before God created human souls. So that tells you that God knew before he created the first human soul, he knew what he wanted the human soul to be able to do, what he wanted, how the human soul would be governed, how the human soul would be helped to grow, but he also knew that the human soul may choose to degrade. And he actually created laws that allow for the redemption of a degraded soul. Pretty clever, eh?
Yeah.
It's amazing when you start looking at the laws associated with this pinnacle of God's creation, your soul.
So really I'm just starting to get some sense of how, you know, God must be infinite to create us with this infinite potential. I've never been able to like even get an inkling of what that might be.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is the term infinity, once you emotionally start to feel it, just blows you away completely emotionally. Imagine creating a creation that not only has a certain potential should a person choose to not engage the potential, so that potential happens to be the sixth dimension of the spirit world, but also then to create a creation that if it chooses to receive God's love in particular, but also there may be other God's qualities that God will share, but if it chooses to receive God's love, then it has another new potential, which is completely different than the original potential by factors of 10, completely different, right? And then imagine that God gives you another quality that we have not even discovered that God might be able to give us at this point, and you can only discover it when you're in a union state, and then that gives you the potential of another series of growth where the human soul now becomes a completely different creature again. And again and again and again, theoretically, it could go on for, we don't know how long that could go on. We don't know what the human soul could end up being. But it's all dependent on the reception of and the operation of one of the laws. The laws relating to the highest laws of governance of the human soul, the laws surrounding divine love. So why do we need to know that? Well, we need to see that God had plans for you that far exceed your current conception and far exceed your own plans for yourself. But God engaged these plans, and you will need to engage these plans with the use of your will. You can't, like, it's not something that God's going to force on you. He's not going to make you do it. It's something you can engage. Ben, you had a question.
Was Amman and Amon, were they aware of the higher laws?
No, because they hadn't been educated about the higher laws at all.
Okay. Mm.
You can only become aware of the higher laws by receiving divine love. So the reality is we can talk about these higher laws, but you won't understand them until you've received God's love.
So it wasn't, we knew and lost it over time.
Yep. So they engage the degradation laws associated with the laws of divine, of God, so relating to the human soul. And those laws include things like the law of compensation. So the law of compensation acted upon the soul based on the choices they made in order to redeem them back into the potential of offering the other gift again. So God even knew in advance that if man chose to degrade themselves to such a point that he couldn't give them his love, that he had a whole heap of laws which would fix that problem so that eventually he would be able to offer mankind love again. That's pretty clever, isn't it, if you think about it? It means that no matter what you choose to do, God is always operating for the redemption of ourselves, even though God fully allows you to choose to do what you want to do. He knows that eventually your experience of pain will cause you to desire a different experience. And he even created laws that engage that. And the law of compensation is one of those laws. Yeah, we've got a lot to talk about when it comes about law. But I'm talking about the soul at this stage. So what else do we know about this soul? Well, the soul is joined together even at the time of conception. It remains joined together, and one half of the soul operates upon the bodies that it connects to, and the other half of the soul operates upon the different bodies it connects to, but the soul itself remains joined. You see, I've drawn it in such a way that you could understand, right? Haven't I, in the past? I've gone like this. Here's our soul, and this one gets the bodies, and this one gets the bodies. And you've thought of it as separation, haven't you? Yeah. I've said that it's not separated many times, actually, if you go back over what I've said to you, but you've thought of it as separated. It's not separated. You do not have a consciousness of your joining. That's what causes the illusion of separation. Emotionally, you do not have a consciousness of the joining. So to you, it's as though you are operating as though it is separate. So when you say I, you're really saying spirit body, material body, you're really saying I. That's not God's definition of I. In fact, God's definition of I has nothing to do with these bodies. And God's definition of I requires the other half of the soul. And this is what you are. You are one half of a soul thinking that it's whole. Right now, you are one half of a soul thinking it's whole, feeling it's whole. When I say whole, I mean feeling it's whole. You are one half thinking it's a whole, thinking it's fully self-sufficient, and it's not. It's the beginning of your problems. The lack of awareness of the creation that you're actually already joined, you just are completely opposing the joining. Emotionally, you are opposing the joining. You are in complete denial of the joining. Dave?
So if I heard you right, we're not separate at conception and beyond. And so...
No, but we are not aware that we're joined.
And that's an emotional thing.
That's an emotional thing.
And that's why the emotional aspect of us is so important, to have connection with the other half of ourselves, to be able to connect with God, our celestial brothers and sisters, and so on and so forth. Mm.
Yeah. It's also, when you think about it, you wonder sometimes if humankind didn't have this male-female separation thing going on as we currently do, which is quite a large emotional injury on the planet, isn't it? It's one of the most significant emotional injuries on the planet. You wonder what the next generation of children would feel, because they would feel they're already joined to somebody. And so therefore they wouldn't go off looking for some other partner, because they would know and be aware that they're already joined, and sooner or later they'll meet up with that person. Does that make sense? But at this stage, that's not, that awareness is not in the human race at all. So we've got significant issues when it comes to this joining, if you like, the awareness of the joining. So emotionally, what's happened is emotionally we are unaware. So it's like this has happened now. Right, so emotionally, it's like now there's a separation between the two halves. And this separation has been caused, is caused by emotional barriers and a lack of awareness. Does everyone get that? Yeah. So emotional barriers... There's all this pain and stuff, but even if none of this pain existed, there would still be the lack of awareness. Can you see that? So the lack of awareness is what causes the illusion of separation. And of course, the whole design of God was that initially we begin in a state of lack of awareness, and we'd eventually develop awareness as a human race, but also as an individual. Would begin an awareness that we'd develop. And as the more awareness we have and the less emotional injuries we have regarding the other part of ourselves, the more this gap is reduced in a sense of our awareness. But it doesn't actually exist. The gap doesn't really exist. It's just an awareness gap, an emotional gap, if you like. A gap of cognizance, the lack of cognizance. That we are in fact one soul. And I'm just one half of one. We go to Paul, thanks.
Did you feel that before you met Mary in this life, did you feel these things?
Yes, and in the first century I felt these things. Yep.
So you grew an awareness that you were connected to Mary, even though you weren't with her, and that you were...
Yeah. And I knew I'd meet her at some point. Barring any accidents, or I'd meet her on Earth. If there was an accident, I'd meet her in the spirit world.
So that was something, because when you cleared emotions, that like awareness came to you.
No, remember, I wasn't working on clearing emotional pain that happened from a multi-generational perspective. All I had to do was focus on, in the first century, was focus on clearing emotional pain based around what was happening to me, right, which I had to continue to do the whole time. Because obviously there was a lot of events that happened to me that happened to you, and I had to let myself feel about them. And as I felt about them, I released them emotionally and so therefore maintained the awareness. But if I'd held on to the emotions, chose to, then my awareness would have degraded to the point where I would be in denial. Does that make sense? But that awareness meant that I knew that at some point I would meet the other half of me, and God's training of me, I suppose you could say, which God's been trying to train you as well. If you examine the way things go together, you know, there's barely anything that you can observe from a sexual process on the planet that doesn't involve, there's a few things, but most of them are microscopic, that don't involve two parties. And isn't that God training you as to how God's created your soul to a degree? The application of the lower physical life applying to the higher spiritual life. And I learnt to see the relationship between what God was showing me in the lower compared to what was going on in the higher. If we come down to diet, thanks. Just a couple down.
Now I have another question, and that is, would if we were living as we should be, would animals only have one partner as well?
No, because they don't have a human soul.
Okay, so we're not affecting what they are doing.
No, we do affect what they are doing.
Yeah, I thought that, but not sexually.
We do affect them sexually, yes.
Okay.
By our choices, yes, we certainly do. But it doesn't mean that in the end there are not some animals that were designed differently to the way the human soul works.
So my first question before that one was, could you feel Mary coming closer to you physically, both in both lives?
Yes.
Did she feel the same?
No.
Why was that? Because she just wasn't as developed as you were?
No, it's got to do with the different type of pain that she had experienced.
Okay. Yeah.
Compared to myself.
Thank you.
Yep. Judith, straight behind.
So your awareness didn't help her awareness?
No, it did help my awareness.
No, your awareness helped her awareness.
Yes, it did.
Oh, it did, okay.
Of course. Any awareness of one half has got to help the awareness of the other, does it not? If they're joined. Of course it does. Okay. I don't know if we're ever going to get past this, but Nina, let's go, Nina.
Is it relevant to ask what it is that that keeps the connection happening and intact?
When you say relevant to you, what do you mean, Nina?
Well, from what you're telling me, there's something that keeps me or us connected to our other halves. What is that, and is it relevant?
God created it to be one soul.
So that's just...
It is one soul.
A really powerful force that's just...
There's an energy flowing between the two halves of the soul at all times.
Okay.
That keeps it bound together. Yeah. You can't avoid it. But you choose to be unaware, which is the same as thinking that it doesn't exist, is it not? And then you act as if it doesn't exist, which then, of course, has its consequences upon the happiness of the human soul. We need to move on, though, don't we? There's a lot there, isn't there? You've got some Q&A you can ask about that. Okay, so this is the pinnacle of God's creation, the soul. The soul is the pinnacle of God's creation. Now, let's look at the creation of the two bodies. So the first human couple had their bodies created. So the two bodies, there's a spirit body and a physical body. And the same, of course, you've seen this diagram many times. Spirit body, physical body of... Okay, so we've got our bodies. Now, is the body you? No. No. You all think it is, still. No, it's not you. In fact, after a while, you'll start to feel as you grow that your body is just a tool that you use. And you will feel that eventually. The body is not you. You act as if your body is you because you try to fix your body all the time. So many of you have, you know, if you have a physical ailment of some kinds, you always think body first. You're trying to fix the body. Right? That's an indication that you believe the body is you. The body isn't you, your soul is you, and your body is connected to you. Your body is going to do what your soul instructs it to do. That will either be in an aware state or in an unaware state. An unaware state is that you might have an emotion in you of a certain type of pain in a certain location of your body, and let's say it's here in your heart, and all of a sudden you start getting heart disease and it builds up and it builds up and eventually you have a whole lot of heart problems and you need a bypass and all these other things. Well, that's you not understanding that you, your emotion inside of your soul is somehow locked up that's affecting that body. And so, you know, when you get the operation or you take the pills and medication you need to take to fix that particular problem, you don't believe in you anymore. You're believing your body is you. You follow? And your body's not you. Your body is a tool. In the physical body, it's a tool that you, one half of you, uses to experience itself. And in the spirit world, once you pass from this body, the spirit body is one half, is connected to one half of you, and it's used so that that one half of you, in its unaware state, can experience life. You follow? And I say specifically in its unaware state. Because in a fully aware state, you don't need any bodies, physical or spiritual bodies, in order to function. Right. So, Ben, you had a question.
Is the soul kind of watching us and our... You know what I mean?
No, you've got to get away from this separation thing that you've got going on. You are your soul.
So it doesn't have a separate conscious state watching this state that's unconscious.
No, that's a whole heap of theory that New Age people have developed. And why have they developed that? Because they want to believe they're aware when they're not. So they're frustrated with their own lack of awareness. So what do they do is they create these concepts and ideas, and even religious concepts such as reincarnation are all created with this idea that there's a part of you that's fully aware and there's a part of you that's not. And this is why we need to examine what state you're in at your conception, because we need to see the truth of where you are at your conception. At your conception, there is no conscious state outside of yourself that's examining yourself. There's no higher self. You are yourself. Your soul is yourself.
It's kind of getting it from, because I've heard something, you say something about how you have a mind in the spirit body, but you've also said the soul has its own
but
organs.
You think, careful here, the mind of your spirit body is just the same as your brain of your physical body. It controls the physiological processes inside of those bodies. So your brain in your physical body controls the physiological processes of your body. The mind in your spirit body controls the physiological processes that occur in your spirit body. Does that make sense? Your soul controls everything, right? And your soul doesn't need those bodies. Your whole soul does not need those bodies to express itself. It only needs those bodies while it's unaware of its other half. In other words, you need to have a male body, Ben. You need to have a male body and a male spirit body while you, as a half of a soul, are unaware of your other half. When you gain a full awareness of your other half, you will not need those bodies anymore in order to experience the universe. You need these bodies to experience the universe while you are in a condition of unawareness of the other half. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and this sense that my soul is kind of an energy source out here isn't helping any of that.
Well, yeah, many of you, like, you've got to be very careful here that you don't get caught up in this whole, you know, philosophical mind game, rather than seeing that your emotions and your desires and your passions and your personality and your nature, they are your real self. And this body, like, is just a piece of, is a machine, a machinery, enabling you, those parts of you, your feelings, your emotions, your inspiration, your aspiration, your all of those parts of you, which are a part of your soul, to express itself in the world.
Yeah, and what you talked about the other day, I was wondering, because I couldn't feel that emotion in me, and I was wondering, where is it? Where it feels like it's like buried out there in the paddock or something.
This trouble with denial and all the facade is that it suppresses the emotion, and so therefore it further suppresses the consciousness of your real self. So the more and more of this you do, the less and less you are aware of your real self.
Which is right here.
Which is right here, encompassing your two bodies. Your half of the soul energetically encompasses your two bodies. It controls the operation of your bodies. And in fact, if you do separate the cords of energy that allow the soul to communicate with either both the spirit body and the material body, then, for example, if you separate the cord of energy that allows the spirit body to communicate with the physical body, that's what you call death. That's the separation of the silver cord. And that's what causes death. But it's not death of the soul, is it? It's just death of the machine, the body. And that doesn't cause you to die. You, as a conscious being, will remain completely conscious, in fact, more aware after that so-called death occurs. Right? More aware than you've ever been. It doesn't guarantee much awareness, because most of us on Earth are completely unaware of a lot of things.
Thanks.
Yep. We go out the back to Shula next, and then maybe Eva. And what's my time?
I just wanted to ask, if we're one soul, how would my sin affect the other soul? Would it affect them physically? I mean, their bodies as well? Or?
Well, of course it affects the other half of your soul, because the more you sin, the less aware you become of the other half. And therefore the chances of you joining with the other half are less. And therefore that affects the other half. So certainly a half of the soul sinning certainly affects the other half. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but I wouldn't need to release their sin and they wouldn't need to release mine?
Or? No, because you need to just focus on the part that you created, and they probably don't even have an awareness of what you created at this point, right? Of course, if they were joined to you completely, they would have a full awareness of every sin you've created.
Thank you.
Does that make sense? Hey, Eva, you. No worries. So you can see that understanding this properly, like you're going to finish up asking many, many questions, right? And we'll give you an opportunity to ask a lot more questions, but there's a lot more we have to cover. So we need to stop seeing our bodies as our real self. Can you see that? Our bodies are just an expression of our real self. Our bodies are controlled by laws that don't govern the soul even. And when I say that, the bodies are controlled, for instance, by the law of gravity, but the soul is not governed by the law of gravity. The body is governed by sexual reproductive laws that allow it to produce new bodies for other souls, right? But the soul is not governed by those laws of sexual reproduction. Does that make sense? Because there are physical laws that govern sexual reproduction. So the soul is governed by a whole group of laws that are completely different than the laws that govern the spirit, the physical body, and also completely different to the laws that govern the spirit body. But the soul has control of both the spirit body and the material body. And in fact, you get to a point in your awareness, shall we call it, in your progress, that you can create new bodies. So you can create a physical body to interact with people on earth even though you're in a spirit form. And that's, you do that because you know the laws that allow you to create bodies. So that means that you can create bodies once you're in that state. Does that make sense? And there's plenty of spirits who are celestial spirits who do that on earth. You know, in your life, you may have even met some without even knowing. You know, they usually do it for the point of trying to help you make some significant shift from a spiritual perspective, from a love-based perspective. And depending on the feelings you have, you would attract those events, and they will then give you information which will help you or cause you to ponder to make a choice. Anyway, we need to continue. So here we are. We've got the pinnacle of God's creation, which is the human soul, and the bodies are not the pinnacle of God's creation. The bodies are the highest physical creation of God in their complexity, which naturally makes sense, does it not, given the fact that the soul is the highest soul-based creation of God, the bodies are the highest physical creation of God, and are highly complex, but they're not the soul. And the spirit body is not the soul either. It is a highly complex, and it is the most complex creation in the spirit world, but it's not the soul. And it's not your real self. It's a tool that you use to express your real self. Okay. There's lots of questions, isn't there, that come out, isn't it? Okay. So you need to start writing some of these down and sending them in. All right. So what is the state of this soul at the time of its... at the time of conception, and remember, conception is a process that is engaged, it's a law that covers conception, and conception is a process by which this soul begins its journey of awareness. So the whole point of conception from God's perspective is to have this soul now begin its journey of discovering itself. So this tells us a lot about God, actually, that God wants you to undertake the journey of self-discovery. So God didn't just tell you everything about your own self. God wants you to discover everything about your own self. And God actually created it to be an enjoyable process. Isn't it wonderful? A lot of times we think, no, it's not wonderful. I just wish you'd tell me everything. But the reality is the soul, you can't be taught everything all at once. It's impossible. It's impossible to be taught anything all at once, actually. And the reason why that is the case is because you must go through a process of learning that expands your soul's capacity to understand. And the expansion of your soul's capacity to understand is, in fact, a part of this process. Each time your soul expands, it now has a capacity to understand more. Now, if we receive God's love, can you start to see that we can expand further and therefore understand more? And if we don't receive God's love, then we can only expand based on our own limitations, and therefore there will be a limit to what we can understand. Makes sense, doesn't it? Okay. So when the human soul is now individualized, which occurs at the time of conception, so when you're conceived, you have now completed the process of individualization, and two halves of the soul must complete conception in order to become individualized. So both halves of the soul must complete the process of conception in order to become individualized. That's all they need to do to become individualized. That's it. From that moment on, the two halves of the soul have connected to it, two bodies, which enable each half of the soul to develop, firstly, the awareness of its own half, and secondly, the awareness of its other half. So for the majority of us, we've not even begun the awareness of our own half. And that's one reason why we haven't met the other half. Does that make sense? But God's created a design in the way that he has in order for you to meet the other half and become aware of the other half. And he created that design that would occur naturally on earth for you to meet the other half and become aware of the other half. Karina?
Was there any reason, Jesus, that you put the arrow from the spiritual body to
Right. No, you have to use your mind initially, don't you, to start becoming aware. But eventually all awareness actually is in the soul. So in other words, you become aware of yourself as a half of a soul and eventually become aware of the other half. And you'll only become aware of the other half as a growing awareness occurs and any blockages that are stopping that awareness are removed.
Mm. And earlier you said that the human souls, when you were saying we're the only one that is this and the only one that, did you say we're the only one that has the ability for self-awareness or self-actualization? Self-awareness was what you called. Thank you. Mm.
Ben? Sorry, Ben, down the front.
So actually, like back to that soul having the awareness thing, your other half, even though it's, you can have their awareness if you remove the, because it's your soul still.
Mm-hmm.
So you can, even though they might know different things about all of that,
mm-hmm.
and you don't.
You can become so aware of them that you can feel every feeling they have, every thought they have, everything.
And that's you.
That's you, yeah.
That's too.
You can feel what's going on for them as well as yourself.
I'm just like, because they're like a separate consciousness, because they're different.
No, they believe they're a separate consciousness.
So her mind is my mind.
That's correct. In reality, the soul's mind is one, so her mind is my mind. But if she or I believe we are separate, then I'll think of it as just my mind.
And that mind is just engaging two spirit brains at the same time.
Yes.
Yes.
And potentially even more. Remember, you can create, once you become aware, can create other bodies. So you can potentially use the spirit body minds of hundreds of bodies. The soul is capable of very, very rapid, not only communication, but very rapid processing.
Would you draw that as hundreds of little things inside that soul? Is that how that would be represented?
No. No. The whole soul is conscious of every interaction that's going on. It's more of a time frame thing. The interactions that are going on at the spirit body level are much slower than what the soul is capable of actually doing. And so therefore it's like time slices of a great big processing unit. Do you understand that? So it's like... I'm trying to explain to you some very complex things here, so let me just explain it in an easy way. If you imagine that the whole soul is capable of that amount of processing, right, in terms of amount of processing, and what it does is that depending on the capacity of the soul, how large it's become in its ability, its energy, it can break off bits of its capacity of processing. And one of those is capable of fully controlling a body, a spirit body, each one of those, of any kind. Right? So you could conceivably have, at a point in your future, you could conceivably have 100 bodies connected to the one soul. The one soul is aware of what every one of those 100 bodies is saying in real time. At the same time. Do you follow that? Yeah. And the reason why it can do that is because the soul, once you've unblocked yourself emotionally, because it's all about your lack of speed of processing information is all about your injuries and your lack of awareness, right? So there's those two sides to the coin. Well, you get rid of the lack of awareness and you get rid of the injuries, now your soul, once it receives divine love, it grows and it's capable of processing more and more and more and more things. Does that make sense to you? Well, because it's now capable of processing more and more and more things, it now has the ability to create lots of bodies and have every one of those interact with someone like you in real time, and yet it's aware of every one of the communications that are going on, every one, like hundreds of them all at the same time.
Yeah, the distinction, but that's not the same as the incarnation where you're, that's a no. Different, yep.
The soul requires incarnation in order to begin the process of self-awareness, right? And so there has to be at least one spirit body and one physical body attached to the soul at the time of conception. That's what happens. The bodies get attached to the soul. And the soul then uses these bodies as a way of gathering information about itself, of becoming aware, becoming self-aware.
And that's an expression of itself later.
Yes, and of course that body can die, the physical body can die, and it makes no difference. The soul is still capable. The spirit body is also capable of interacting with the physical world, but just not physical interaction. You know, in terms of you seeing the physical interaction, it's invisible, but it's still capable of interacting with the physical world, therefore still absorbing and learning information about the physical world as well as the spirit world. Yeah? And that's how it learns, it's gathering information. If we go across to Liam on this side.
So with that... basically, you can give this presentation at the same time to everyone all over the world, and it's you giving it rather than videoing it and them seeing it. They're watching you in person.
Yes.
All at the same time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. So that'd be pretty weird, hey? You see a recording at what's the time now? 12:25:38 seconds. Now here, and then over the other side of the world, there's a recording at the same time over the other side of the world, and I'm there too. Dressed differently, but I'm still there talking about similar things or even different things. Does that make sense? And Mary and I are there, and Mary and I are here too. Can you see it get a little confusing sometimes, but this is what the soul's capable of doing. Okay. Now, we need to say a few things here too. So let's continue, because I've now got 5 minutes to cover 50 minutes of material. At the conception process, the soul itself is without sin. The soul also doesn't know what sin is. So not only is it without sin, it is also unaware of what sin is. And the soul may remain unaware of what sin is for years, even hundreds of years. Many of you have remained unaware of what sin was for most of your life. So, you know, the soul is capable of maintaining states of a lack of awareness for long periods of time, or becoming aware. And it's the will that determines whether it becomes aware or remains in a state of unawareness. The will, the desire to discover, which God has actually inbuilt as a personality, as a natural trait in each human soul. Many of us have that suppressed very rapidly soon after conception. So by the time we're born, we have little to desire to discover. And then as we grow, we get smaller desires to discover generally. Not always, but generally, particularly when it comes to soul-based awareness. In other words, the desire to discover stuff about the spirit body and stuff about the soul is almost non-existent on the planet. Right? And usually the person in the spirit form is engaged in the discovery of a whole heap of things in the spirit body, because that's the time they become aware that they have a spirit body. And so that's the time they become aware that they could discover more things about the spirit body. Does that make sense to you? And so in our physical form, we are aware of our physical body, so usually we use our physical body for discovery. But we're often not using our soul, we're often not using our spirit body. We're often in denial of those things through a lack of awareness, and also because of the different emotions we are suppressing, which cause us to deny awareness, cause us to deny things. And as a result of that, we don't discover a lot of things we could be discovering. So that's why most people pass from the earth without knowing hardly any of the laws that govern their physical body. And in fact, it's usually only after they pass from earth that they develop a desire to know the laws that govern physical bodies. And so they spend a lot of time interacting with the earth, discovering those laws that they didn't learn while they were on earth. So at the point of incarnation, you can see that we're clean. We're a clean soul, unaware of itself, unaware that it can sin, but also not having sin. So it's not sinned yet. It's incapable of making a loving decision. It's also incapable at that point of making a loving one. It's incapable of making a loving decision or an unloving decision, because it's just in the instant of gaining a self-awareness. And you need self-awareness in order to make decisions. So that tells me, and it should tell you, that there's no such thing as a person who comes onto the planet with all this knowledge. In fact, what we've written on the outline, if I just have a look at it, it's on the page 2 of your outline, says, I've written, at incarnation I am undeveloped in all aspects, including I don't have a love of God, I don't have an awareness of God's love, I don't love my other half, I don't love myself, I don't love others, I don't love the universe, I don't have God's truth, I don't have personal awareness, I don't have personal knowledge, I don't have personal wisdom, personal power, and I'm even not aware of my personal potential. At the moment of incarnation, I am a blank slate. Now that flies in the face of almost all New Age concepts, does it not? But it's actually the truth. And you can see that it's probably the most logical truth, is it not? Louise, if we come down to the front.
So AJ, the influence of genetics, where does that come? Like, if often people say, oh, that baby's got a bad character, or you know, or develops a disease. I mean, I know we've talked about that, but...
Genetics are only a part of the body. They're part of the laws that govern the replication of the body. They don't govern anything to do with character or nature or any of those things.
Or illness. Is that the parents'
Or illness. So the soul governs illness through sin.
Yeah. And the parents' unhealed emotions can cause illness in the
well,
child.
Well, no, the parents' sin causes the illness in the child.
So genetics have no influence on the character? Or
not on the character of a person, no. In fact, it's the soul of the previous generation that has an influence on the genetics. There's laws that govern how genetics, how things can replicate physically, and partly that's under the control of the soul. It's the other way. So it's the other way around than what most people realise.
As a society places so much emphasis on genetics. I mean, plus the nature-nurture thing.
Yeah, the whole nature-nurture question is interesting in itself, in the sense that, of course, the nurture side of things is where unloving things have happened to the soul, and they, of course, do have negative consequences to each soul, because the soul absorbs the unloving behaviour and the lack of love that comes to it. So certainly they have an effect, but the soul itself has control over all those things, both our soul and the soul of others.
So I guess I've got a personal thing because I feel it was bad, but
So there's no such thing as you being bad.
No, it's unloving.
Genetically.
False belief, yeah, but... So the character of the baby is a result of the unhealed emotions absorbed from the parents.
No. We'll talk about that in our next talk.
Thank you.
That's a good question, though. Dave, if we...
So if God is good and gives gifts of goodness, what gifts of the soul do we start out with?
Very good question, Dave. That's why we're having our next talk, which is called exactly that. God's gifts to our soul. Yeah, so we need to, of course, understand. Now, there's a whole heap of this presentation that I haven't gotten to, and we're already close to 5 minutes over now. And that's knowing some of these things, what effect does it have? So what I'd probably like to do is just briefly read to you from the outline some of these things. They're on page 3 of your outline. If you look under what God's creation of myself means, what does it mean for my relationship with God? Well, what it means is only this soul can have a relationship with God. So you can't have a relationship with God through your pain. You can't have a relationship with God with your facade. It's only this real self that God created that is capable of having a relationship with God. The relationship with God has to include both halves of the soul eventually at some point. God wants a relationship with the unified soul. God designed the universe so that God could and the soul could have that relationship. And the relationship results from a will-based choice of both halves being exercised in harmony with love. So it has quite a large impact on the soul and its relationship with God, knowing these things. What about its relationship with itself? Well, only my real self can have a relationship with the other half of my real self. I can't have a relationship with the other half of my real self through my pain or through my facade. And in fact, my pain and my facade cause a fracture of my awareness of the flow of emotion and other feelings and types of energies that flow through the soul. So only my whole soul, only one half of the soul has to make a choice, a will-based choice, to discover the other half. While you continue to make a will-based choice to deny the other half, this will never happen. codependent relationships, which are born out of pain and facade, they're born out of addictions. Remember, we talked about the vortexes of unhealed emotion. Codependent relationships are established through those vortexes. They repel the other half of your soul. They destroy the potential of a relationship with the other half. So even if you're in a relationship with your soulmate right now, if it happens to be based on addiction, codependent addiction, you are actually pushing each half of yourself away from yourselves. It's actually a very self-destructive thing that you can do, living in codependent addiction. Very damaging. Now, of course, remember we said sin and all of its subsequent creations are all the creations of mankind, therefore must be removed by humankind. And if they're not removed by humankind, will have a definite impact upon whether the soul becomes aware and able to energetically experience the other half of itself. Right? What about my relationship with the universe? Well, if we look at that, I am automatically using my will. I am automatically under the control of governing laws. There are some laws that I have no awareness of, but which are operating upon me right now. Law of compensation being one of those laws that the majority of humankind are unaware of, but it's operating at every moment upon each half of the soul. And then there are other laws that the soul itself must engage. And in fact, there are laws that determine the separation or the what you would call the awareness of the joining, the lack of awareness of the joining. There are laws that control how you become aware of the joining of the two halves. And there are laws that are that you have to engage. You have to know them, discover them, and engage them in order to undertake the process. If you don't, it will never happen. If you don't do it, undertake those particular laws, the awareness of your own joining would never happen. So six fierce spirits who've met their soulmate usually live with their soulmate, but they still haven't joined. They still haven't joined. There's still no awareness of their actual being one soul. They still see themselves as two separate, distinct individuals. Many of you also are refusing to see yourself as one half of a soul. That obviously is going to have a deep impact on your ability to ever have happiness with the other half of your soul. Many of you have neediness projected towards the other half of your soul. That repels the other half of your soul because it's an addiction. Huh? If we look at it for my development, I can see that the development of my physical bodies is really quite pointless. The development of my soul is the thing I need to focus my attention on. I can see that if I concentrate my effort on the physical and spirit bodies, I'm concentrating my effort on the effect of what my soul does rather than on my soul itself. And the development of the whole soul, obviously, is dependent upon the development of the two halves, particularly their development of becoming aware and removing the sin that causes a lack of awareness, the separation, the illusion of separation. Okay, now there's many other things that I could read out there, but they are the main things I wanted to mention. The other thing I wanted to mention are my current state. And this, again, I'll just briefly cover this because we haven't got time. But for the majority of us right now, the so-called adult who we are right now is like a little baby child when it comes to understanding any of this. Is that not true? We're still largely lacking in God's truth about the human soul. We've not received enough of God's love to understand it yet, and we've only developed the areas where fear and false definitions of love have allowed us to develop. So at this stage, we're pretty much completely unaware from an emotional perspective. And let's look at the attitudes of the pain. The pain thinks that it is your real self. And I frequently hear you guys telling me how you feel, but it's really just how your pain feels. It's not how you, the real self, will feel down the track. It's just the pain that hasn't been released wants to start seeing itself as your real self. Right? So the pain has this idea that it knows the truth, its definitions of love are correct. It denies the awareness and existence of the real self, because the pain actually prevents the awareness from occurring and causes a separation, the illusion of separation between the two halves of the soul. The pain does that. And so the pain thinks that itself is your real self. It believes, the pain also believes that it will be attacked for being your real self. And there's a large part of your global fear. A large part of your global fear is that you do not want to be your real self. You are terrified of discovering and being your real self in the world in which you live. Your parents did not wish you to be your real self. They wanted you to be their creation. So a large part of your global fear is your fear of being your real self. Does that make sense? Now, the attitudes of the facade are even worse, aren't they? Because they support the pains in its belief that it's its real self. And the facade is basically saying, I support your false beliefs. The facade saying, I'm going to create imaginary ideas about what you're going to be. And what does that do? It further removes you from your real self. The pain denies, excuses, and minimizes and lies about the real self. The facade wants the denial of those things, because if it feels those things, then it will feel pain, and it doesn't want to feel pain. So the facade is trying to suppress even further the real self. You are going to struggle to fully engage your real self unless you are willing to release both your facade and your pain. So for the majority of you, what I feel from you is just little peaks of the real self peeking out behind a very scared, piece of fabric, just looking out into the world occasionally. And to be frank with you, for 50% of you, I don't even feel that. It's unusual for me not to be able to feel a person's part, at least a part of their nature, right? But for some people I meet, I cannot feel any single part of their nature at all. And what that tells me is that their real self has been suppressed from the moment of conception, and they haven't even been allowed to develop even one part of that real self. And so I can't feel their real self. It's like they don't exist. And there's examples of that in the Paget messages, where people came along to Paget saying that they felt their soul had died, that they felt their soul had shriveled up and died. And that's what it's like initially. The real self has been so undeveloped, it's like it's still the little speck it was at the time of conception, without any ability to grow, you know, due to constraints placed upon it by the environment and parents' sin, society's sin, and eventually their own. Pretty interesting, hey? But the majority of you, particularly when you start engaging some of your will, I start to feel you. Feel parts of the real you peeking out, as I said, from behind the scared window, you know, the window that hides all the fear. Well, that's a lot of information to absorb in a short period of time, and we could have covered a lot more of it, unfortunately, but hopefully I'll try to do that in our next group, and you'll be able to see a bit of more of the extra information in the next group. But what we'll do now is we have a 10-minute break, so if we come back at 12:55, and then we need to ask some questions about this, so we'll try to focus our attention on some questions about our real self.